Okay. This is prophetic, God, you feel it in the air. Mic test. 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 1,000, 2,000, 1,000. Mic test. 1,000. Mic test. There's no more mic, is it? Mic test. Okay, too bad. Mic test. Oh, okay. Hi. Everybody, can we all put our bags at the back of the Audi? Then everybody, let's make a circle before we start gym, okay? Come, let's go. Got a 2:30 already. Come on, let's go. Bags at the back of the Audi. Come on. Put at the sides also can lah, but the back is great. Then stand up and make a circle, come. Inside the Audi, but at the back. Okay, those who are ready, come make a circle. Come.
Okay, y'all don't know how to form circle, right? Then sing song, okay? Ready? Make a circle round
and round, round and round. Come on! Hey, this one not childcare lah. Y'all understand instructions, come on. Okay. If y'all don't remember, usually before gym starts, we'll all make a circle, we'll stand around, and then we'll all pray together before gym starts, okay? So we pray for the program. So today I think there's nothing special. The program is rather straightforward. Okay, so today Seth is speaking, so just pray for a smooth run of the whole gym session, and then pray for Seth, who will be speaking, okay? And then pray for the AV team also, that everything will be smooth, no hiccups and anything for live stream lah. And there will be fun day later, so hopefully the ground downstairs will be dry, no rain later. Then we can enjoy fun day, okay? Okay, at the count of three, everybody pray out loud, okay? Then Joel also can close us. Okay, 1, 2, 3.
Okay, let's pray. Father, thank you for this time of this afternoon where we can really just come together to worship as a family of God, Lord. So, Father, so I pray for each and every gymmer. May their hearts be receptive and open to your word. May the words that Seth is about to speak really sink deep and bear fruit, Lord. So, Father, so I pray for the overall gym program. Just pray that may run smoothly, and I pray for fun day later. Pray for good weather, that the floor may be dry. Yeah, that we'll all be able to have fun together a lot. So thank you for this time of gym and committing to your hands. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Okay, everybody, come to the front. Come to the front. Because your friends will be coming in later and they'll be filling the bags. So I need everybody to come to the front. Those who just came in, bags at the back. Humans in front. Put your bags at the back of the Audi. Don't bring your bags. Put your bags at the back of the Audi. Don't bring your bags. Come in front, come in front. Y'all don't need to be in yourselves. Y'all can stand on your own with your friends. Those who just came in, you can put your bags at the back of the Audi. Okay, so sorry PA, can we have the lights first? We haven't shared Fig Tree yet. Yeah, okay, so for Fig Tree today, we have Rianne from Pine. So everybody listen to Rianne.
Hi everyone. Okay. So today my sharing is quite short and simple. So basically, like, I'm really grateful that in my school have like a Christian community. So we have like a Christian fellowship group. And then I have like friends who are like really like walking with me through my Christian journey as well. And it really helps me because it helps me grow my faith. And then when school gets tough, we can just pray together. And then recently we've been sharing like worship songs and like devos together. So yeah, that's my sharing. Thank you.
Thanks, Rian. So next we have Zach from Aspen.
Okay, hello. So my Fig Tree is fairly simple. So I'm thankful that for the past week, my time in camp has been like very minimal. So I could spend a lot of my time just like hanging out with friends and family lah, which I think I'm very thankful for. And helping me like build relationships and like just bond with my family lah. I think it's very important and I'm very thankful that I'm able to do that despite supposedly supposed to be serving the army. Yeah, thank you.
Alright, thanks Rian and Zach. So hopefully y'all have your community that y'all can hang out with in school as well and strong family support lah. Okay, so let's all stand for worship. Everybody stand and take 5 steps forward, okay? Everybody stand first, come on. Okay, those who just came in, can you put your bags at the back of the Audi, okay? Those who just came in, put your bags at the Audi. Okay, we are going to count together because some people don't know what is 5 steps, okay? So when I count, you all take 1 step forward, okay? 1, 2, hey, come on, move. 3, 4, 5. Okay, five. Thank you everybody.
Okay, yeah, so you put your bags at the back so that you have more space to come together, I guess, yeah. Maybe you can go take it later before someone. Yeah. Okay, well, we are quite small today, but I think it's because people will be coming in later. So, I think as we just come today and worship, remember that you can sing. Can sing with your mask on, and God wants to hear our worship through anything like we can be clapping or dancing, or yes, singing is the easiest way to worship God. But I really hope that all of us will really find meaning in worship today, and yeah, just be able to praise God with everything that we have.
Oh,
Grace, and it's only by grace that we are able to live our lives for you. And I just pray that you continue to heal our hearts in any situation, and just continue to show us your love, even when we don't deserve it. And with everything we have, I just pray that we continue to worship you and praise you through anything in life.
Show me how to love like you. process. Father, we thank you, Lord, that in you there is hope of a glorious future. We thank you for Easter, that at the cross and through your resurrection, you have accomplished for us eternal life, and you have accomplished for us abundant life in this present age. Eternal life has begun, because eternal life is about the knowledge of you. It's about peace, it's about righteousness, it's about grace, it's about comfort, and it's about hope. And we look forward to the day when there'll be no more weeping, no more mourning or crying, because all things are made new in the new heavens and the new earth. You will come again. That's the mystery of our faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Come, Lord Jesus. Be in our midst as we worship you, pray, and hear your word this day. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated for our prayer. Today is the prayer focus is on missions. So once a month, we'll be praying for missions related point. And for the first month of each quarter, we are praying for Block 1. Okay, so how many of y'all know that we are involved actively in Block 1? Okay. Okay, so I just want to begin by giving a quick status update of what's been happening at Block 1. I'm not sure how many of y'all know what's been going on. Can I have the next slide, please? Okay, so you probably recall at the start of this year in January, we had the Chinese New Year goodie bag distribution. You might remember this scene in Century 2. We are attending the briefing for the CNY distribution. And then in that very week, that same week, some of us had a burden to restart the weekly Saturday visitations to Block 1. The Sunday after, we did a recruitment call in JYM. And we have 15 JYMers now involved in this weekly Saturday visitations, where we just go out as a team to befriend the residents. Yeah, so we just go to their homes and knock on their doors and just be friends with them, lah. Yeah. So on a regular Saturday now, there's about 7 to 8 of us on a typical week who go out, and this has been going on for every week, or almost every week. So I've gone out for about 10 times now, 10 visitations. So really thank God for moving the hearts of JYMers to be involved in this. I just want to say, if any of y'all, anyone else is interested at all, please feel free to join us. Okay, even if you are not sure whether you can commit long term, just want to come for one Saturday or two Saturdays to see what it's like, just let us know. You can let me know or let Samuel know or your cell leaders know. And every Saturday we go out, yeah. And you are attached to a team, so you always go in a group. So don't worry. We have a couple of sec ones who are with us, and it's open to all. Okay, there's no minimum age. Or you can sign up through that little link, the tinyurl.com/teamblock1. Okay, and the recommended commitment, if you get involved in it long term, is not every week, you need to be there, but once every 2 weeks, typically. Okay, so right now we are seeing about 10 units, We are befriending 10 units. We have good rapport with them already. And next slide. We also started to communicate with the Chinese congregation visitation team. Okay, so the Chinese congregation, not sure if you're aware, they have been doing this for many years now. Many people are involved. And they visit another 40 plus residents. Next slide, or next point. Yeah, and so we are collaborating with them. Just to give a heads up on some of the things that are happening really soon. For example, there's going to be a Parents' Day service in May that the Chinese congregation is organizing, and we're going to help to knock on doors, distribute flyers, and invite them to that service. There's probably going to be outings. Help me to click, yeah. Possibly to Gardens by the Bay, so just bring the residents out. Table tennis, line dancing, all that's resuming. You might remember pre-COVID we had all those, so now restrictions are lifting, and all that's going to resume, as well as a special Mid-Autumn Festival program, So as these programs roll out, I will announce them to y'all, and you can get involved in these ways as well, okay? So it may not feel like visitation is something for you, but you can help to distribute flyers, you can help to organize part of the program, part of these events. You can get involved in those ways as well. So I'll just announce when the time comes. Okay, next slide. So these are prayer pointers for today. Firstly, Thanksgiving. We thank God for raising a team of JYMers who are involved in this to build friendships with 10 residents so far. And the friendships have been going very well. Second, thank God for the COVID restrictions lifting and the collaboration of the Chinese side that we're able to do outreach together. Okay, next slide. Okay, for this next part, I'll ask Russell So to share how we can pray for some of the residents.
Hi guys. I'm just going to be sharing some prayer pointers for specific residents that we have been following up with as of late. So first one will be Uncle of my Auntie Hamsa. They are this lovely Malay couple who we've been following up for quite a few years now. They've treated us with nothing but love and hospitality. So basically for them, Uncle Othman has a lot of health problems. Like really, it's quite shocking the amount of medication that he takes. So things like, he just came out of the hospital from pneumonia. Recently, he's told me something like heart murmurs. His legs are numb and pain at the exact same time. It's really very weird. So just pray for their physical health. And Auntie Hamza is his sole caregiver. So they live together. Uncle Othman's about 80, Auntie Hamza is around mid-70s. So it's really taking quite a physical toll on her. So first prayer pointer would just be praying for their physical health and well-being. Second one would be their emotional strength and to grant them peace. Because Uncle Othman has some early onset dementia, and it might also be partly because of his medication, but he has quite bad mood swings. And because they live together, Auntie Hamza she bears a lot of the burden of that. So in this, I guess just pray for peace and for emotional strength for both of them through this period of time. Next slide. Next is Uncle Muhammad. He lives alone. He's this also a Malay uncle. He's super chill. Usually we come, he's having his afternoon nap, but he'll make time to come and talk to us. So it's quite nice talking to him. So for him, pray for his mental well-being. He is emotionally quite a strong person, but he does suffer from some mental health issues. He is seeking professional help now, but just pray for him that he'll get better and that the professional help he's seeking will help him in the long term. And next one would be for his, forgot to open his heart. As of late, he has been very open for to us praying for him. He's been quite accepting, and sometimes it depends on his mood, but mostly he's okay with us praying for him. So I guess just pray that God will provide the right opportunities for us to bring God into his life. Next slide. And lastly is Auntie Ma. She's a new resident. So we just met her during the Hari Raya outreach recently, one of the distributions. She's very excited that we come and visit her. And I guess for her, she does know about Christ. She hasn't explicitly said that she's Christian. So for her, just pray that, firstly, she's been very willing for us to pray for her. So just pray that she'll continue to keep this curiosity and keep up this passion and this excitement that she gets whenever we come to see her. And secondly would be, to remain in high spirits. So actually, she's not super healthy. She does have her fair share of health issues, but it's not too bad. A lot of the time you go and see these residents, they'll say, oh, 老人是, it's just old people problems. So just pray that it doesn't get worse, that she will continue to remain healthy, and pray that she will continue to keep this energy. Is it possible to get the all three slides on the thing? Wow. Okay.
I don't know whether PA can work some magic to make it a bit bigger, but can we get into groups now? Maybe of four people per group to pray through these items. Yeah.
sure to tell, for the dry season is over, there is a cloud beginning to swell. To the skies, heavy with blessing, lift your eyes, offer your heart. Jesus Christ, open the heavens, now we receive the Spirit of God. We receive your rain. We receive your rain. Every seed buried in sorrow,
okay, let's draw our prayers to a close. Another 30 seconds. Those who are done can quieten down, please. Okay, let's pray. Let's pray. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are God who sends us out. Sends us out to be your witnesses, to be your light in this world. And Lord, we have a mission. Till the day you return, Lord, we want to be found faithful, bringing your light to people who are so in need of you. We pray, help us to love our neighbors well, the people right at our doorstep who have so many needs, physically, socially, emotionally, and most of all, spiritually. Help us to be your hands and feet. Help us to be Christ to them. Would you move more hearts, Lord, to be involved in this work of outreach to our community, to our neighborhood? Help us to be a church without walls, a church that exists for the Holland neighborhood, a church that is not a holy huddle, just for people to have a good time and to just enjoy each other's company, but a church that embraces the stranger, the broken, the lost. And we pray that you help us to reach out well to the residents that Russell has shared about, as well as the others that we're also befriending. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Shall we stand to pray the collect together? Oh, sorry. Offer tree first, right?
Offer tree first. Then we will say the collect. Okay, if you have your money in your bag and you forgot to take it, then you can go take it. Oh, my guitar! Okay, hope you have your money prepared, and as the offertory bags go around, you can put it inside.
Found love, you're no reason. You gave your life, your all for me. Call me yours forever. Caught in the mercy for love. Found hope, found life, found all I need. You're all I need. The time has come. Stand for all we believe in. So I, for one, I'm gonna give my praise to you. Today, today, it's all of me. Oh, the way the praise goes out to you. Yeah, the praise goes out to you. Today, today, I live.
Praise goes out.
us say the collect together. One, two, three. Almighty Father, who is in your great mercy, glad the disciples with the sight of the risen Lord, give us such knowledge of his presence with us that we may be strengthened and sustained by his risen life and serve you and continually in righteousness and truth through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Okay, y'all can go and take your bags from the back and come to the front with your bags again. Thank you.
You can sit with anyone you want, okay? If you don't know who to sit with, you can sit with your cell leader. The best seat is in front. Don't need to look around. Just come in front. Come, come. Alright, alright. Settle down, settle down. Settle down, settle down. Come this side, sit down already. Okay, hi everybody. Welcome back to JYM. Can we remind each other what does JYM stands for? Not convincing enough. JYM stands for? Yeah, okay. So welcome back to JYM. It's nice to see all of you back here, even though I know it might be near your exam seasons now. Okay, so hope you all are able to just put all these worries aside. Yep. And then we'll just focus on the word that Seth is going to give us today, lah, okay? So today we have Seth who will be starting us on a new sermon series, lah. Okay, while they set up, let's pray for Seth first, okay? So y'all can raise your arms and, yeah. Okay, come, let's pray. Father God, we just pray for Seth, Lord Father, that you empower him, Lord Father, even as he speaks to us today, Lord Father, that he truly speaks from what he hears from you, Lord Father, and that for us as well, Lord Father, that we'll just be open to hear what he has to say, Lord Father, to really just put aside other thoughts that we have in our mind, Lord Father, and to really just be able to focus and whatever that Seth said, Lord Father, that we will just be able to apply in our lives as well. In just name I pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Okay, hi guys. Before we start, anyone who is like new to JYM and don't have the JYM journal yet, anyone don't have the JYM journal yet? You don't have, we want to pass it one to you. We still got a few more extra. Huh? She don't have the what? Oh, the bag. Yeah, we only give the book. Okay, can. If you don't have the JYM journal, tell your cell leader and we'll get one for you, okay? Yeah. Okay. Today we are starting a new sermon series. It's on the book of Haggai. Who has read the book of Haggai? If you don't know, I will give you some introduction later. So we are moving from the God's big picture to the new one. Haggai is about stewardship. How can we use our time, our resources, our talents for God's kingdom lah, in the right way that he intended for us. Okay, so settle down. you have your gym journal, take it out and can write some notes around on your phone also can. Okay. Yeah, us, but no. Okay. So I was reading like recent news of renovation disasters lah. And especially in the time of the pandemic, there was quite a lot of problems like in the home renovation scene. There were not enough workers from Malaysia, there were not enough supplies coming in. And the news just this week and a few weeks back, people keep on complaining about their horror stories of projects that were very badly done, things were not done well. So you can see some of the defects, like there were drill holes in the wall, the things weren't straight, it was all the wrong colors. And then you must be wondering, what on earth are this renovation company doing? How come they can do such a terrible job and they are like okay with it, right? So if you are like a homeowner and this was supposed to be your room, will you accept it? You also wouldn't lah. It's very bad quality. Yeah. And imagine if they did this quality for your house and then you, okay lah, you're a bit angry, then you go down to the renovation company and then you trying to ask them, hey, what are you doing? Then you go there, then you see them playing on your mobile phone. You see them go and just eating around. They're just lazing about. You feel very frustrated. Why are you not focusing on the right thing? You should be doing my house properly instead of just doing your own thing, relaxing, enjoying yourself. And I think it's a matter of priorities, right? If you prioritize the job, the renovation of the house, you cannot just leave it like that and call it like, okay, that's enough. And there were like homeowners who complained, like they did halfway, then after that, the contractor was uncontactable. They couldn't even contact them again. So it's quite a scary thing for many homeowners who trying to get their renovation done. And even as many of you as kids, right, I remember when I was a kid, this is a Nintendo system. For those who don't know, this is what I played in the 1990s. This was where you open the cover, then you put like, you buy individual games, cartridges, and then you like load it, and then you play. Only two buttons, A and B, right? Because, and Mario is only A, lah. There's only jump, right? So, I remember every time when I want to play games, I would come and ask my mother, hey, mom, can I play games now? Can I play my Nintendo? Then she will say the few words that no child wants to hear, lah. Have you done your homework? Wow, then, jialat lah. I also don't know, not yet, almost done. Cannot, you must finish your homework first. Why is that so important to do your homework then you go and play games? Because it's a matter of priorities. Is you are working on the right things at the right time. And I think the book of Haggai, it talks about having the right priorities in life, as whether in renovation or in your life direction, it will affect the whole way your life turns out if we do not have the right priorities. So let's turn to the book of Haggai, which is a book about unfinished renovations. So some background to this book, kind of like history to the Jewish people, so that you can understand the context of the book. So in 585 BC, BC is like, it goes backwards. It starts from BC, gets 585, then it decreases until 0. So 0 is the kind of the year that Jesus was born. Then you come AD. So like we are in AD 2022. So this is like, you have to think, it's like negative, negative 585. So in 585 BC, the Jewish people were unfaithful to God. And because of their unfaithfulness and their sin, God let the Jews be destroyed and taken away as captives by the Babylonian Empire. The Babylonian Empire today is the modern Iraq, the Iraqi people. And they were exiled from their homeland for 70 years. However, in 538 BC, quite a few years later, the king of Babylon was kind of like dispossessed. He was conquered by the Persian king, King Cyrus. And King Cyrus, he was favorable to the people of the Jewish people. And he actually gave a ruling that he let them go back to their land, to go back to home, to Jerusalem, even though it's all been destroyed, the temple has been destroyed, everything is in ruins. But he told them that you can go back, I'll let you rebuild your land, I'll give you the supplies and the money you need to construct everything that you need to construct for your home. So that was God sent provision. So they went back, the first group started going back in 536 BC, they started rebuilding, but they only built a little bit, and then there was a lot of opposition from the surrounding nations, the Arabs and the local Palestinians, and all the different empires around them. They didn't want to see them rebuild their homeland. They didn't want to see them rebuild their temple because they were not welcome. So because of the opposition, the Jewish people totally gave up their rebuilding project for, you guess how long? For 16 years. 16 years. So who is 16 years old here? not so. Double, more than double. So imagine 16 years, right? It's like the time when Ryan Ng was born until now. 16 years, so long. Such a really long time to stop a project, right? 16 years. And in 522 BC, actually another king took over, King Darius. He was also a king that was, he was open to religions and he was open to them actually continuing the rebuilding process. But the Jewish people were kind of like very, they didn't jump on the opportunity. They still like for 2 years, they didn't want to do anything. They didn't want to start rebuilding. That's when God sent Haggai the prophet and another prophet, a book, Zechariah the prophet. He sent actually Haggai to ask them, to tell them to rebuild the temple. Don't wait so long. What are you waiting for? And that's the focus of the book of Haggai. And the main point for us today is this. If your life is out of place, check if God is in the right place. If your life is out of place, check if God is in the right place. The outline for today's sermon is the people's problem, the divine diagnosis from God, and the repentant response of the people. So the first one, the people's problem. So what was happening during that time? Actually, there were clues that something was wrong. In Haggai chapter 1, verse 1, in the second year of King Darius, on the first day of the sixth month, the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai to Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest. So just take note of these two characters, Haggai speaking to Zerubbabel, and who was kind of like the governor, the one in charge, and the priest, Joshua the priest. He was supposed to go back, the first Jews to go back, and then to set up and rebuild the place, okay? So Haggai talked to them, and we jump to verse 5. Now this is what the Lord Almighty says. Give careful thought to your ways. You have planted much but harvested little. You eat but you never have enough. You drink but you never have your fill. You put on clothes but they are not warm. You earn wages only to put them in a purse with holes in it. So what was happening? What was the problem at that time? There were many, many problems. That's why God was telling them, consider what you're going through now. Give careful thought to your ways. What was happening? Their life was out of place in every aspect of their lives. What happened? They were planting crops, but the harvest was very poor. It was terrible, the output. They were eating, but not full. Imagine you eating at a very good restaurant and food, and then after you eat, you still feel hungry, you still feel sian, like not satisfying. You drink, but your thirst is not quenched. You have clothes, but it's not warm. It doesn't work. And they also earn money, they earn wages, but the money somehow, it just can't keep the money. It's just lost somehow, whether through unexpected financial concerns or certain things cropping up, and then they lose their money. So these signs were the kind of the clues that something was wrong in their life. They were not blessed, they were not productive. Even they work hard, there was very little output from their work. And their money was dwindling away slowly. So Haggai said, look at these signs, look at the problems in your life, and you have to wake up, because this is something unusual. This is actually a curse from God to them, to actually show that something was up and they need to change their ways. And we read in verse 10 and 11, therefore, because of you, the heavens have withheld their dew and the earth is crops. God called for a drought on the fields and the mountains, on the grain, the new wine, the olive oil, and everything else the ground produces, on people and livestock, and on all the labor of your hands. So God was the creator, the controller of this world, and he was the one who can even withhold the rain. That's why their crops are all failing. There's no output from their hard work. All their crops were ruined. All the labor of their hands were destroyed. And it sounds really terrible. Like, why would God do such a thing? And I think the divine diagnosis, God tells them exactly why he was doing this. Is the main thing that God was telling them is, finish building my house or I'll finish you. Finish building my house or I'll finish you. And the divine diagnosis was given in verses 2-4. God tells the people the reason why they're facing all these terrible things. This is what the Lord Almighty says. These people say, the time has not yet come to rebuild the Lord's house. Then the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai. Is it a time for you yourselves to be living in your paneled houses while this house, God's house, remains a ruin? And that's the reason for all the problems that they were facing. All the lack of productive work, all the loss of money, all the lack of enjoyment in life. Is because they were focusing on their houses. And while God's house lay in ruins, they did not rebuild God's house. And you know the word I put in the phrase, paneled houses, right? There's a paneled. Is it time for you to live in your paneled houses? He's talking about luxurious, fine houses. It's not that it's wrong to live in nice houses, but when you live and without the presence of what God wants you to do, it's like you just only focus on your own life and your own possessions instead of God's task for your life. So in verse 9, he continues explaining, you expected much, but see, it turned out to be little. What you brought home, I blew away. God blew away. Why? Declares the Lord Almighty, because of my house, the temple of God, which remains a ruin while each of you is busy with your own house. The word busy is like, in the original word, is people are only running towards their own house. They're only concerned about their own lives, their own prosperity, their wealth. They weren't concerned about the things of God, even though it was in ruin. So the question is, what was not having a temple, what does it actually imply about the people in their thinking? The temple actually, it represents the proper worship of God, and it also shows that it's a place where God dwells with us through the temple. And I think by saying that I don't need to build the temple or I don't want to build the temple, actually it means that we can live our lives without having God at all. We are living lives without the presence of God. We don't need God for my own life. I'm happy to just do my own thing. I just study. I just do my own sports, my own hobbies. I don't really need church. I don't need God. It's just an additional thing, optional add-on. So I think for the people, not building the temple actually meant that they didn't really need God in their life. It shows this neglect. And I think it's a sinful thing, having the wrong priorities in their life. So the question for us too is, whether do we neglect God in our own lives? Do we only focus on things that are just for the present, our studies, our grades, our fame, our popularity, but we neglect the important things of God, worshipping Him, spending time with God? Do we neglect God and live as if God wasn't important, whether we have Him or not? So Haggai came to tell them to put God in the right place, the right priority. Otherwise, everything in their life will be out of place, as is the case. So for some of you, you may feel that your life is out of place. Your grades, you're working very hard, but it's not getting very good grades. Or you're spending on food and drinks, but you don't enjoy it. Or you try and save money, but your money just runs out somehow for some unknown reason. It just drops in the drain and you can't take back your money. It may be God's alarm bell to us, telling us that maybe there's something that God wants us to turn back to Him. There's something in our life that we need to address. That God is actually waking us up to show us there is a task that He wants us to accomplish for Him. It might be a commitment to serve God, that you gave this promise, I'll serve God in gym, I'll do this for God. But along the way, you kind of like have dropped off, kind of like forgotten what you actually promised to serve God. Is it a possibility that God may be actually drawing you back to Him by adding these problems to your life? And we may have given excuses, just like the people of Israel. It's not the right time. I'll do it later. But we never get to doing it. So the people say that the time is not yet right to build the Lord's house. So I think this is quite a subtle difference. Like, it's not telling God, no, I'm not going to build God's house, but I'm going to build it later. Hang on, wait, it's not important now. And I think that's the danger for us today. We try to procrastinate, we try to push it to another time. And the further and longer we push things away, higher chance that we'll probably forget about it. We'll forget about doing what God has told us to do. And I think we need to realign our priorities to what God wants for our life by seeing, is there something that God is telling us through our daily lives that we need to turn back to Him? We need to repent of our sinful ways of putting other things above and God's priorities for our lives. Of course, it does not mean that having problems in your life means that you have sinned. I'm not saying that. It may not be a sinful things will automatically result in suffering. There are many sinful people who don't, on the surface, do not suffer. They do not go through tough times. They don't go through problems. But I believe that we need to be like the Israelites, right? Like God telling them to think, to consider their ways, to give thought to their ways. So I think we need for ourselves to analyze, to ask God, is there something in our lives that is not right? To ask God to diagnose our condition. Are we obeying God? Have we done everything that God has told us to do? Or is there something that we need to repent of in our lives? So the diagnosis for the people of Israel is that they need to start rebuilding the temple. So how did the people respond when Haggai came to them with the diagnosis that all these terrible things are being done on you by God because you have not put God first in your life? We turn to the repentant response in verse 12 and 13. How did they respond? Then Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and the whole remnant of the people, everyone who came back, obeyed the voice of the Lord their God and the message of the prophet Haggai, because the Lord their God had sent him, and the people feared the Lord. Then Haggai, the Lord's messenger, gave this message of the Lord to the people. I am with you, declares the Lord. So in humility, in humbleness, they accepted the message that they had done something wrong with their lives. And they accepted that it's because I had not rebuilt the temple. I accept the diagnosis and I know I need to change. I need to repent of what I've done. And that is what the people did in humility. They feared the Lord. They accepted that they need to rebuild the house of God now. So what does it mean when the phrase says to fear the Lord? I think there's one element of it being scared, lah, to know God is really the God who is all-powerful and He can stop the rain. He can stop every blessing in your life if He chooses to. And He can even end your life because He is the controller, the master of everything in the universe. I think that's part of fearing the Lord, to recognize He is really awesome and powerful. Much like your discipline master or teacher in school, He has the power to discipline you and to make life like a living hell lah, on earth for you if we do not obey Him. Lah. But I think there's also an aspect not just of rest, of just like being disciplined and being scared of God, but also to know that He loves us and He will help us complete the task. And that's why in the second part, God told them that in this task may seem very daunting, it may seem impossible, something that you feel like for whatever reason you didn't want to complete it, God tells them that I am with you. God will be with you to help you finish the task. He will help you do whatever He asks you to do. Because God will never give you a task that He will just leave you alone. I'll come back in 3 years. You just hope you have done it. But He walks with us all the way to make sure that we are able to complete the task He has given us. He promises to be with us. And I think it's very encouraging that God never gives us a task that we are not able to do without with his help. Lah. If He gives us a task, He will help us to do it. There's no challenge, no temptation too big that beyond God's power and help. And that gives us the hope that if God wants us to do something, if God commands of us something in the Bible or is revealing something to your life, whether visiting Block 1 or doing something for Him in gym, God will supply with you the strength and the energy to do it. And we read that the people were energized. They were energized when they heard that God was with them. In verses 14 and 15, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor. I don't know why they keep on repeating the rank and name again and again. Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and the spirit of the whole remnant of the people. They came and began to work on the house of the Lord Almighty, their God, on the 24th day of the sixth month. Note the phrase, God stirred the spirit. God stirred the spirit of the leaders and the people so that they were energized, they were motivated, they were passionate about building the house of God again. It wasn't like, sian lah, okay lah, I'll do it for you lah, but like half-hearted, you don't really want to do it. But they were like really like prime, like pumped up lah, to really do the work of God excitedly. And the phrase stirred up, actually it talks about rousing from someone from a sleep to wake them up from this slumber. And really that is like God waking us up from this tiredness, from this whatever reason it may be, the procrastination. He's waking us up and giving us the energy to complete the task that He has given to us. So even as we may feel sian with the commitments we have in gym or school or family, ask God to stir your heart, stir your spirit so that you can be energized to do the task for God. And He will give you the energy and the excitement to do it. And I'm very encouraged by Ryan sharing about Block 1 that they are all very excited to go to visit the residents weekly. And it's really encouraging. Yeah. Thank God for that. And if you are interested, please look for Ryan. So within the same month, the number system is very weird, right? 24th day of the sixth month. But that is roughly August, the last part of August. So within the Haggai preaching the message, within the same month, 3 weeks later, they started rebuilding. It was really a fantastic response to the message of Haggai. And because they put God in the right place, we shall see the results of that on what happened to their life, what happened to their life. We'll see that in the later chapters in the next few weeks. Okay? So what does it mean for us today? Are we supposed to rebuild temples? Are we supposed to build up St. James Church, tear down the sanctuary? Are we supposed to build chairs? Are we supposed to give money to the church? In a sense, yes, lah. We're supposed to give money to support the work so that it can continue. The work of God can continue as we worship Him, as we run services for the worship of God. On one sense that we should support the physical church, but the church is more than just a building. The church is not a building, actually. It's actually the community, the people of God. And I think we need to look deeper into what the temple means today for us. How do we rebuild the temple, and what does it mean for us today? So firstly, the physical temple, anyway, the physical temple was destroyed in AD 70 by the Romans, and it has never been rebuilt because the Muslims, they built the Dome of the Rock on the exact same site. There's only one wall that is left, the Western Wailing Wall that is left. And many predict in the last days, the end times, that the temple will be rebuilt. But as Christians, it's not really important that the temple is rebuilt. Because of Jesus, He came to this earth. And Jesus is the God's temple. Because God dwell in human form, Jesus is the greatest temple today. When He took on human flesh, Jesus Himself in John chapter 2, He referred to Himself, the body, as the temple of God. And as believers, we are often referred to as the temple of God, the house of God. And when the Holy Spirit, God, dwells in us, we too are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Jesus is the cornerstone, the foundation of the temple. And actually, Peter, in 1 Peter, he actually tells us what is our role as the stones in this new spiritual temple. Peter tells the believers, as you come to Him, the living stone, talking about Jesus, the living stone, rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to Him, you also, talking to all of us like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. So what are we today? We are all living stones. We are the bricks. We are the panels. We are the parts of this new spiritual temple to bring glory to God. And I believe God is, through our discipleship of one another, helping each other live holy, godly lives, to put each other, to love each other, to help each other put God in the right place, to put Him first in our lives, we're actually building a more and more glorious, wonderful temple on earth. Not a physical one, but a spiritual one that people all can see us as the physical, the spiritual temple shown in human form, how we live as a believers today. And I want to encourage all of us to put God in the right place of in our lives. And as we disciple and as we live holy, godly lives, and we encourage each other to live holy, godly lives, because we are each the stone in this spiritual temple, we will offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God. We show this world that God is worthy of worship, and we draw this world to Him through the way we live our lives. So the question for us today is God in the right place in your life today? Is God in the right place in your life today? So let's bow our heads in prayer. Jesus is the cornerstone, the living stone that was rejected by humans but chosen by God and precious to Him. Have we built our life on Jesus yet? Or have we built our life on something else? We may build it on self-confidence. We may build it on our grades. We may build it on our looks, our appearance. We may build it on fame or money. All these do not last. And we need to put our trust in Jesus today. And if it's your desire to put your faith on Jesus, the living stone that will build your whole life, you can pray this prayer with me. Dear God, sorry for my sin. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross for me and rising from the dead. Please come into my life and save me. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So let me close in prayer. Dear God, thank you for the book of Haggai, Lord, that reminds us, Lord, that when we do not put you in the right place, our lives will be out of place. Lord, we repent of this sin of neglecting you and often not focusing on the right thing. Lord, help us to focus our lives on you, and Lord, in your mercy, bring us back to you when we have strayed away from your purposes for us. Help us to put you first in our lives and really to seek this kingdom and your promise that all these things will be added to us. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So these are the discussion questions, and hope you have a good discussion later.
Thank you, Seth. All right. Hope everyone got a good summary of Haggai from Seth today. Okay, can we give Seth a round of applause again? All right. Welcome back to JYM, everyone. It's nice to see everybody back, although somehow it looks emptier today. Yeah. Anyway, who's having exams soon? This week? I know uni kids having finals, right? Okay, all the best. Nice to see all of y'all here though, even though y'all have exams. Yeah. Alright, before we start, do we have any newcomers today? Any newcomers, cell leaders? Okay, if not, find out the name of the person sitting beside you, if you don't already know their names. Okay, find out what they ate for lunch, okay? Find out what they ate for lunch. Okay. I hope y'all know each other slightly better now. Y'all can talk more later, okay? Okay, come. So today we just have two announcements. Yeah, so first we'll have Anna.
I'm so tired of planning GPSAs, camp practicals, CCA stuff, and more. I would just much rather plan like some games.
Did you say you want to plan games? You can help us plan games for mission trip.
What? We're having mission trip this year?
Yes, we are. In fact, this year it's going to be online. So, this mission trip is targeted at Malacca kids, and it'll be online, yes. It'll be in collaboration with other churches.
Oh, cool. When is it? And what are we going to be doing?
It'll be held over 2 days on the 2nd and 3rd of December. But we may have more programs lined up. So look forward to more information in the future. For now, we just have to plan. Oh my God. For now, we just have to plan 2 online games with a storyline and objective given to us already. Do you want to help us plan it?
Yeah. Oh, but I'm not sure if I can commit in December. Can I still help with the planning?
Yes, of course. If anyone else wants to join us in planning these games for mission trip, just let your cell leaders know. Then cell leaders, please tell Anna or myself by this Thursday, 26 April. More details will be given soon. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Anna and Vanetta. So If all of you should be free, right? Because it's your December holiday. So if you are interested in planning games, even if you're not in Gamescom, please do join them. You can contact Anna and Vanetta, okay? All right, so next, there's Sunday Fun Day today. So Joshua will be doing it today. So if you are free after cell time at 5:15, you all can go down to the plaza and play. I think the number of people that can play at one shot is like 30. Yeah, so don't worry about the numbers. Just come down and play. Yeah. Yeah, so last point, Prayer Combs want to... Everybody shh. Okay, yeah, last point, Prayer Combs wants to remind you guys that Saturday morning prayer is still ongoing. So it's every 9 a.m. Every Saturday morning on Zoom. So they made it convenient for anyone to join la. Yeah, so next week, if you are free on a Saturday morning, 9 a.m., do join us for Saturday morning comp prayer. It's Saturday morning prayer, sorry, not comp prayer. Okay. So before we go for cell, let's all stand and say the Aaronic Blessing. Okay, stretch out your hands towards your friends, people you don't know. Okay, 1, 2, 3. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His All right, have a good cell time.